Okay, hey, that works real well. Let's try and get started, eh? Okay, Yogi, I will get started. Hey, Mir, forgive me, there was probably a better way I could have handled that. It was no big deal at all. It wasn't even a deal. I am very nervous about this next step. Putting metallic on. And sticking to this paint scheme gimmick concept I came up with. Starting where people can't see anyway. Let me clock in so I can get paid. Be able to go fast and loose. I want to start slowly before I rev up the engine. That reminds me, there's this racing board game that I'd really like to get and add to my prospective gaming group game nights, but it's freaking $75. Oh yeah, just use every emoji in the box. Hopefully you can see some of this. You have one of those, don't you? Warhammer Champions Arena. I don't know what that is. Warhammer Champions Arena. Warhammer Champions, there's the collectible card game, if that's what you mean. Probably should be using a better brush. I'm figuring out that with metallics, I need to make sure that it's hitting the my light source, my actual light source, just where I can see it, where it reflects directly back to my eye, or else I can't tell what I'm doing. I thought I seen a beta model of an Inquisitor who looked like he was an old school New Scholar armor, and their character comes in those Arena Champions boxes. It's something that I did. I've never done an Inquisitor. Okay, so with this Necron model, I keep picturing somebody putting a light or lamp behind it and a person in front. Viewing it almost like you could hear the sizzle or heat glow off the miniature. That's nice. That means it's evocative. Now I just need to pick a better brush that wants to get ruined. trying really hard to keep it starting small. Yeah, it's like if my light isn't reflecting the metallic directly back to my eye, I pretty much can't see what I'm doing. Right, I think I'm gonna keep this minimal to this point. It makes his legs look silly. I think with that note, I need to push it up further because it's just going to look out of balance due to the nature of the light. If I don't bring it up to their chest and face, it's just going to make their legs stand out in a silly way. I cannot tell if any paint is coming off the brush. This brush is already just about as ruined as the first one. It takes that much time. I also just really want to try not to overcomplicate it. Really seeing how true metallics are completely reliant on a light source, whereas opaque paint, you just paint in the light source where you want it. Don't really want to draw any more attention to the feet. No, this is Vallejo, metal color. At least in my head, this concept, and the thing I like about it is like you don't. Like, the story it paints is that you don't realize that they're machines until they're right on top of you. And then you just catch the glint of, oh, they're made of solid metal. And I'm dead. Man, my eyes are still burning from yesterday. That makeup I put on my waterline. Looks like the new RoboCop. No one's better than the old RoboCop. The old RoboCop is without flaw. Get the fuck out of here. Sorry. I was expressing anger at myself for not noticing I was getting metal paint all over this dude's bicep today. I haven't quite slipped into a space where I feel confident about this step yet, so being a little bit harsh on myself. Grab yourself a good agitation brush. That cleaned up good. Thank you. Okay, gotta keep reminding myself these models are never gonna get flipped upside down. And be viewed from the bottom up. I'm definitely gonna have to push beyond the threshold that makes sense if I want these to appear balanced at all. Most of these interesting highlights are going to be underneath where no one can see them anyway. Okay. Walk away. Right? Right, Alton Brown?
That's right, Jason. I'm Alton Brown.
Take a short break. Where's the button? Hey, let me look at, compare these first two guys to each other and see if there's any major discrepancies that I pushed a little further on that dude, but just barely, fortunately. And just when I had one little tiny line to his face, his cheekbones. Gotta accentuate those cheekbones. Okay. I'm gonna go freshen up. Today's another day where nobody here except for me, so work is now my kingdom. Hell yeah. Time to piss in the sink. Little chickies are very important. Alright, I'll be back. Oh, you're talking about cheeks. Yeah, the cheekbone highlights. This is the most meticulous and slow-moving step of this paint project, but it's also, won't take that long, but I'm just going to really pace myself over the next couple of days on this. It's a high burnout step for sure. When it's done, though, I think it'll be mostly done. The more I think about it, the more I'm leaning towards not actually using the airbrush for the OSL. Or at least not starting with the airbrush. Man, this guy's got a bunch of crap on his arm. It's directly dark outside here, it's so strange to see. It's only 3:43. Yeah, that's weird. Welcome to winter. Now, if there were only 5 of these dudes, I would be having a blast, but there's like 16. I'm going to start picking up the pace and being less precise, because I want to do it that way. First one or two dudes, you know, you take your time, you get a feel for it, and then you go. I was actually considering just dry brushing dark metallic all over the front. I do wonder how different that would have turned out. Thank you. my kitty and the kitty that it wasn't getting along with. I think they're finally coming up with their own games to play. It's progress. So I'm choosing not to paint the guns any metallic, because in my head they're black. In my head, but then again, I feel like they would all just be made of the exact same material. So I might come back later and edge highlight the guns. But, I don't want to do that unless it's absolutely necessary. I think I'm really understanding metallic paint in a new way. So with this this approach and this project, and I'm seeing its flaws or its challenges. I think that's a good thing. It's a good opportunity to learn. But it's almost like painting, like I'm thinking about it at the moment, of like, almost like painting with clear coat that's glossy. Like there, that's a good way to think of it. Like if the light isn't catching the gloss coat exactly, then it's basically invisible. But then with the final product, if the light isn't catching it exactly, it's going to be invisible as well. And that could be a good thing or a bad thing, but it's worth taking into consideration. But a lot of times my like metallic stuff will look fine until I photograph it, and then it's like, oh my god, it's just all over the place. Are you saying they possibly have become friends? Oh, yeah. I think that they're starting to hit like an equilibrium. Like, so my cat is Toto and the house cat is Pee-wee. And Pee-wee's definitely at a point where she does want to play with Toto, but she plays real serious. She actually is a hunter. She actually goes out and hunts. And so they kind of have to establish some kind of medium meeting place where it's not. Anyway, it seems like they're starting to figure it out. Hopefully you can see a little bit of this. It's definitely taking a lot more of my focus than normal. Try and aim this. Like at the moment, I'm feeling like I don't actually enjoy working with metallic paint. Which is fine for right now. Like, you know, I've been wanting to explore non-metallic metals. And I've started to, so it's just, maybe it's a good time. Whenever I like really think about a particular set being like a slog or daunting or intimidating, I remember painting that Bad Moon moon shrine. Is just sort of like a reminder of. With that thing, I really had to just tell myself, like, if I just show up every day and do some amount of work on this, as far away as it seems, like, eventually one of those days I'm gonna go, oh my god, it's done. And then it was. It's really looking good. I hope so. It's a little weird. I think this is the strongest one so far because his stupid legs are being hidden by that shroud. That's why he's wearing that. That shroud. I wish I thought of a funnier name to call it, but it's got a shawl. So cover his embarrassing thighs. That's the Necron weakness, is make fun of their thighs. They're really sensitive about it. Sensitive thighs. Like, I can't help but notice this guy has an extra big gun, and he has that, like, shawl, like, covering his thighs. See right through it, man. Oh no, I accidentally just looked at these and thought that I wanted some of them. I realized I have the Space Marine Adventures Labyrinth of the Necrons game. And I was like, oh, those are those guys from that game. I just realized I'm painting them, but then I have to give them away. I'm pretty sure the old Necrons were on 25mm bases and the new ones are on 32. I don't know if these are a direct replacement or if they've done the thing where it's like, okay, both of them are now individual rules. It's okay though. The Labyrinth of the Necrons is not a very good game. Let me say, it doesn't have a very high replay value for me. There's only one dude with the protective shawl covering. Oops. I got at least one more dude in me today. Maybe two. Let's cross our fingers for two, because I gotta get more work than 1 hour in. Okay, one thing I like about this right away is I preserved a lot more of the darks. That's going to give me a lot more to work with. Tomorrow I might actually put this metal paint on a dry palette. It's so thin to begin with. It's just so waterlogged. I'm having to like throw half of it away every time I pick up more off the palette. Way too much water in it. It's an airbrush paint, and it's supposed to be that way. But then, adding water from the wet palette. Oh god, that made me jump out of my skin. Hey, thanks, Anonymous. I wonder who that was. I'm presuming that was you, Miar. Unless there's a username anonymous. I don't know how it works, man. I appreciate it. Thank you. Really helps offset my charging way too little. Come on, man, it was you. I know it was you, man. There's no such thing as Santa Claus, man. It's kind of cool though, for like the benefit of the cat that's a little bit more aggressive. I don't think she's ever played with another cat until now. Because the cat she grew up with in the house like absolutely just hated her and bullied her all the time. Well, I don't know. Don't quote me on that. I don't know how accurate that is, but something to that degree. Hello, I'm Hello Kitty Trooper. I donated to 10. Well done, kind sir. I like Hello Kitty Trooper. Thank you very, very much. Looks really good. His elbow and shoulder area look really good. There's a bit of spillover of the edge highlight. Yeah, I kind of wish I had done that in more places. I could go back and put more in, but. If I were painting these for myself, I would. Because that looks dope. It really marries the two. That shoulder looks dope. But there are certain things I have to come to terms with that the client isn't going to notice or appreciate. But would still have to pay for. And so it's something I have to just develop a sense for. Something did just cross my mind. I was kind of thinking like, you know, because I think that if I'm truly painting for myself, I shouldn't be charging the client for that. Unless we really have an agreement that that's their, and sometimes it is like that, this particular client where they're like, just paint it how you would. If I were to paint stuff first and then put it up for sale, then I could paint whatever, however the hell I wanted, you know, and charge whatever I wanted. And people would, you know, the right person would pay. Whoever bought it would be buying it because they did appreciate those things, the details that have. The details that have justified the cost. Anyway, my point is, usually I think that painting stuff first and then putting it up for sale is out of the question, because usually people want armies painted and then everything needs to have be in cohesion. But games like Kill Team, I can just buy Kill Teams or Warcry Warbands and paint them however I want and try and charge exorbitant amounts of money. But anyway, with skirmish games, I can just paint one-off themes. And, you know, probably someone will buy them. And what I could extra do... Okay, shit. No, there's still downside. Fucking UW. Pissing me off. The downside there is that there's more... They usually make more than one way to build them. And so they won't be built correctly. So forget it. Forget it, it's hopeless. Because, I was, I guess I was thinking in that moment, like, crazy. No, I was thinking that, these guys just came out of a Kill Team box and they were only built, they only build one way. And I don't think that that is actually accurate. But maybe I can talk to my client about it for advice on how it works behind the scenes. And because I can't rely on one client to keep me employed. Only game that I can think of that it would work would be like a boxed game like Worm Quest, but the problem there is there's so many freaking models by the time it gets painted and up for sale. And I've watched people attempt to sell painted sets of Warhammer Quest, and in my what I've noticed is it doesn't sell well, but maybe it's worth revisiting. I hear you on the magnetized parts, but I don't know if it would work for me or not. It would take all the extra time of magnetizing them, and then all the magnetized bits would have to be painted as well. And then it would be hell of expensive. Which is to say, it's not where I'd want to start. I'm trying to look for the simplest starting point. Some kind of skirmish, one way to build it kit. Thank you.
Solid.
When I get comic books, I'm going to monetize them for sure. What's Kalanath? Can't remember. My thoughts on that with GW games is like, I can't even get them to the table fast enough. Before the whole game is invalidated or updated or changed. Like, there's no way I'm taking extra time to magnetize my options. A little bitter. Again, if it's a game that you're going to be playing for years or decades, monetizing might be a really good idea, like as an investment, because when they do fuck the rules around, you can make changes a bit more. It might be easier to change with the rules by having monetized options. It's too heavy-handed, but I'm just gonna leave it. Kind of probably broke continuity with this one, but whatever. Whatever, man. Okay, walk away, please. We've had enough of this guy. Actually, I can see another thing. With the fact that no one can see any of this metallic unless they're looking from underneath, none of it's going to show from the tabletop unless I overlap it towards the top. Like these shoulder blades, you couldn't see any metallic. So I brought them forward a little bit, but I love how those cheekbones are shining. That's gonna look terrifying when there's some glow behind them. This is our prize winner, front runner, dude. To me, that's the reason you magnetize it, because you can always change them out, legal weapon, right? Investing in your investment. Probably just gonna ignore every detail of these bases besides the natural airbrush paint. Looks like there's 15 models. Alright, I'll be back.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to try and do one more of these dudes. And then I think that's all I got for today on this step. There's so much fucking water in this. Duty. Hello, Duty. Welcome back. I will be rapping after this dude. I'm on a very meticulous and slow-moving step. Makes for faster burnout. I've been really struggling with my microphone sound. And blending with the music that I'm playing. It's been difficult for me to figure out, like, what's best. The best approach. One thing I notice is, like, it's... If I play back a broadcast and I listen on my laptop speakers, it sounds so different than listening on headphones or a different speaker, like a full bigger speaker, right? And that's totally normal, but as for an audio production endeavor, you know, it's typically you want to strike a balance where it sounds good on any system. I'm wondering if there's actually too much. Let me put it this way. I'm wondering if there's not enough highs coming out of my microphone. Oh well. Hey Bahamut. You're back again. This Novak or just lights? Novak. I don't know what that means. But I have to go for a second because I have to. I'll be back in a minute. Oh, I think you mean like, is it paint or is it just a light? I have to go to practice in a minute. All right. Well, thanks for hanging out while you could. I can't tell when it's in focus or not. Okay, let's get this last dude for today wrapped up. Shall we? I got an itch. Sorry about the camera work today. Really having to get into a lot of nooks and crannies, and it can be, especially the crannies, can be difficult to keep on screen. I heard some cat puking sound, but it wasn't. All right, now I need to check something. I feel like I might have missed the neck pinions on one of these guys. Pistons. There's one so far. I missed the neck pistons on one of these guys. That's what you get, man. Trying to go back and mess. Just seeing so many of these lines are just never going to be seen. if I don't pull
people
them.
People can get a cheeseburger anywhere, okay? They come to Tchotchkes for the atmosphere and the attitude. Okay, that's what the flair's about. It's about fun.
Thanks for coming to Tchotchkes. Fred Sants. I guess I'll just have to paint another guy then. Thanks for the follow. Appreciate it. But yeah, I was saying that if I don't pull a lot of these metallic lines up towards the face, they're all just going to never be seen. And then, therefore, it's a waste of time and money and paint and etc. Looks like some of this is on camera. I also may go back and pull the extreme edge highlight more towards the front. It's on one of these guys has that. And it looks cool. That's what I'm trying to say. Happy accidents. And such. In case anyone ever flips this thing upside down on the table, and you're like, oh, there's some metallic-y bits down there. It could happen. Not so great on that one, but that's all right. only going to make it worse if I keep touching that spot. And all of a sudden, the metallic paint is too thick. Just like that, it leaps from being nothing but water to too thick. That's what happens, man. Oh, crapple. Something about this one spot, I just keep biffing it. Okay, do I have it in me to do one more of these dudes? I guess that was the last of that dude. I thought I had one more of those dudes to do. That was the last one, so. I think I'll probably wrap here then. Got about 10 hours on this project at this point. And I'll pick up tomorrow with the disruptor dudes. I don't know if that's what they're called. Warlords? Something. Anyway, thanks for joining. If you did, thanks for the follow. And hopefully we'll see you again real soon. Cheers.